A very good morning to all. Looking at important headlines from the Hindu newspaper for 9th March, Saturday. On the front page you have, Supreme Court appoints 3-member panel to mediate in Ayodhya dispute. So this is regarding the Ayodhya land dispute case. A 5-member constitution bench is hearing this case and now it has been decided. Earlier too we had seen Supreme Court spoke of mediation. Two parties coming together and trying to find a solution rather than Supreme Court giving its ruling. So now this has officially been kicked in. The 5-judge constitutional bench of the Supreme Court hearing the case has appointed a panel of mediators comprising of 3 members. Former Supreme Court Judge F.M.I. Khalifullah is the chairman of this mediation panel, and Art of Living founder Shri Shri Ravi Shankar, who had himself come forward to for mediation so that a solution can come forth. He is also included as a member in this panel of mediators as a 2nd member, and 3rd is Shri Ram Panchu, who is senior advocate with experience in alternative dispute resolution. So alternative dispute resolution is actually a terminology which is used for resolution of cases through mediation or through other ways rather than through court rulings. So this mediation would start in a week in Faizabad district in UP, where the disputed site is located, and the entire process would be conducted in camera. So these are the details of the 3 members of the panel of mediators too. Also, the Supreme Court has stressed that there is a need for utmost confidentiality in the proceedings, in the conduct of this mediation process, so that it is a success, and that's why the court has given its opinion that it might be best if the media refrained from reporting the proceedings. So this is the point which has been put forth. But then you should know that the Supreme Court has not passed any gag order. So a gag order means a restriction on the media. So there's no gag order of the media. It is left to the mediators to pass necessary orders in writing if required. And also, the Supreme Court has given the mediation panel 8 weeks. But then the court has urged the mediators to conclude at the earliest. Also, they have to file a status report in 4 weeks. Then next is ArcelorMittal to take over debt-ridden SR Steel. So this is regarding ArcelorMittal SR Steel case, which has been going on for long. The case is going on before the National Company Law Tribunal, Ahmedabad. So now you can see it has been approved that 42,000 crore resolution plan of ArcelorMittal to take over SR Steel in Gujarat has been approved. So this is finally the mega deal, which came almost 583 days after National Company Law Tribunal began the insolvency proceedings as such. So it should have been mandatorily completed in 270 days, but that is around 9 months, 6 months plus an extended 3 months, but it has taken almost 583 days. And finally, the resolution came forth. ArcelorMittal's plan has been, resolution plan has been approved. So you should know the background also. There is the entire timeline given of the case before the National Company Law Tribunal. So the case was admitted by NCLT in 2017, August 2017. Finally, you can see in 2019, finally ArcelorMittal's plan has been approved. Another plan of Ruya's, the owners of SR Steel themselves, to come up with a resolution has been junked by NCLT. So if the owners themselves now have a plan to bail out the company, that means they were able to do it earlier but they didn't go ahead with it and the case went on for so long. Because SR Steel, you should know, it has a 10 million ton steel mill at Hazira in Gujarat and it owes 49,000 crore to over 24 banks led by the State Bank of India. So there are bankruptcy proceedings. There is bankruptcy proceeding which is going on against it. So this is there. So it's actually one of the 12 largest non-performing assets accounts identified by RBI too. So now this resolution is finally coming forth. So recovery of dues will be significant for the sector too. So you can see. So the SBI and Standard Chartered Bank actually filed insolvency proceedings against the company. And this you can see in June 2017, and next month in August 2017 the proceedings were initiated. So original promoters SR Steels, that is the Ruya brothers, they have lost control of their once flagship facility now. Also, you should know that Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code was amended in November 2017 to after the case was initiated. So, this amendment barred or restricted promoters of companies of defaulting firms from coming with resolution plans. So, this bar has been in place. So, Ruya Brothers' claim cannot be admitted. Their resolution plan cannot be accepted. Then below you have Rafael documents not stolen. Attorney General does U-turn. So we saw the government represented by Attorney General submitting in the Supreme Court. Yesterday it was front page news that Rafael documents have been stolen. So the documents which have come out in the media, the Hindu had an exclusive report along with ANI. So these documents, the Attorney General said, have been stolen. And the government is planning to initiate action against official action under the Official Secrets Act against them. So it's a criminal case which would be initiated. That was the submission which the Attorney General made in the Supreme Court, and now it has reversed its stand and has put in a submission in the Supreme Court that the Defense Ministry's documents pertaining to the purchase of Rafael aircraft deal, they were not stolen from the ministry. Because after that news coming forth, the Hindu reported that if the documents have been stolen and that is what we have in our hand, if that is what the government says, means that it is accepting that these documents and the content which is there in the documents and what has been reported by the media is correct. So now the Attorney General has clarified that the petitioners had used photocopies of the original papers which have been deemed secret by the government. I don't know how, what difference would it make. So this is there. Then here you have only 3.32 lakh MSME jobs created in last 4 years. Find CII survey. So this is Confederation of Indian Industries, which comprises of more than, which has undertaken a survey of more than 1 lakh companies. So it says that the number of net jobs created in micro, small and medium enterprises sector, MSME sector, in the last 4 years stood at just 3,32,394, which is 13.9% higher than the base 4 years ago. So this is the CII survey findings. So for this 4 year period beginning 2015-16, it does a comparison with what the Ministry of Small, Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises has been saying that earlier it was 11,54,293 MSME jobs created in the last 3 years before these 4 years which have been assessed. So the number of jobs created presently turn pale before that earlier figure. It says that just three states, Maharashtra, Gujarat and Telangana, accounted for over 50% of the jobs created. So that is further set back. Means it was not an evenly spread out job generation to in micro, small and medium enterprises. It says 73% of the jobs were created in micro enterprises out of the three categories, that is micro, small and medium. And when you say net jobs basically means jobs or recruitments which are there excluding the exits. So there are retirements, exits also. So excluding those exits, how many recruitments took place, how many net jobs were created is looked at. The next news is, you will be in trouble if anything happens to the Aravallis. So this is the Supreme Court's warning to Haryana. So it says that government should ensure that no harm is done to the ecologically fragile Aravalli Hills. So bench led by Justice Arun Mishra is responding to this submission made by Solicitor General Tushar Mehta that he would prove that the state had not introduced amendments to Punjab Land Preservation Act in order to give leeway to illegal mining or builders in the region. So Supreme Court is concerned about the Aravallis, and the government representative, the Solicitor General, also says that we are also concerned of the Aravallis and no illegal mining or building has been approved there. Then on page 7 you have, do forest surveys separately. So this is a high power committee constituted by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, which has recommended that forest surveys, which are a biennial exercise, means once in 2 years exercise, which is conducted by the government to estimate forest cover. They should explicitly demarcate trees grown in forest from those grown outside it. So there should be separate surveys, means an afforestation is seen. So plantations and private lands have to be separated out from forest. So currently the government counts both towards estimating the proportion of India's geographical area covered by forests. So critics have always argued that this is not giving a clear picture about, you know, forest coverage, and it's not an ecologically sound principle. So now government constituted committee has recommended so. That was a committee by the Ministry of Environment. So you can see there has been a marginal 0.21% rise in area under forest between 2015 and 2017. So this was a report of the government, India State of Forest Report, which was made public in Feb 2018, a year ago. So the coverage of forest in the country is 7,08,273 square kilometer, which is 21.53% of the geographical area of the country. So India should have at least 33% of its area under forest. So that has been a long-standing goal of the government since 1988. So India State of Forest Reports come out, you know, every 2 years. So it is around 21.53 now, and that is also including, you know, areas outside the forest, that is plantations or other such, you know, private lands. Then here you have cancer drugs 87% cheaper after trade margin cap. So a trade margin cap has been put on 42 anti-cancer drugs. So when this new decision was taken by the National Pharmaceutical Pricing Authority, NPPA, so around 390 drugs have been put on this list of those whose prices have to be capped. The margins can be maximum, you know, 30% of the price. Trade margin cannot be more than 30%, you know, as such. So when this 30% trade margin has been put on these 390 drugs, 42 of them are anti-cancer drugs. So because of this margin, now their new MRPs have seen an 87% fall. So they become 87% cheaper. Then next is UIDAI to levy fees for verification. So this is the decision of Unique Identification Authority of India. So it says that business organizations will now have to shell out rupees 20 for each customer verification and 50 paise for authentication of each transaction done using Aadhaar. So this is the charge which would be imposed on usage of Aadhaar. So this is a decision of UIDAI. Aadhaar authentication services which are done by UIDAI, they will be charged. So each EKYC transaction will be 20 rupees, and for each authentication, whether the data is authentic or not, with a yes no answer, 50 paise would be charged. And this is exempt for banks. So when it is private entities, business organizations, charges would be there, but then it will be exempt. Department of Post and government entities, they would be exempt from this authentication transaction charges. So this is the decision now being taken. So here you can see the details given. So entities shall be required to deposit the authentication transaction charges within 15 days of issuance of the concerned invoices based on the usage. So delay in payment beyond 15 days will attract an interest, a compound interest of 1.5% per month. And also discontinuation of authentication and EKYC services would happen. So they have to pay these charges. So they say that per KYC businesses were incurring a cost of 150 to 200 rupees without Aadhaar. So with KYC, with Aadhaar authentication, they would be saving these costs. So this is much lower, the costs rate which is charged, it is said much lower than the other KYC process which is being used by agencies now, private agencies. Also, you can see scheduled commercial banks engaged in providing Aadhaar enrollment and update facilities in accordance with the gazette notification also shall be exempt from authentication transaction charges. Then below you have Gadkari flags off project for Delhi-Mumbai Expressway. So, Union Minister for Road Transport and Highway Nitin Gadkari has laid the foundation stone for 1,320 km long Delhi Vadodara Mumbai Expressway. So, this has been developed at a cost of 90,000 crore rupees. It is expected to be ready by 2022. So, the expressway will decongest the Mumbai Delhi National Corridor or the National Highway NH8. And also, it will reduce the distance between the two cities by about 150 kilometers. So, you can see the important cities which will come along the expressway are Kota, Bhopal, and Indore. So, and distance between these important cities, Delhi and these important cities, will also be reduced. And below you have the same front page news continuation regarding Aravallis. So, the Supreme Court has given a warning to Haryana government against doing anything to harm the ecologically fragile Aravallis. Then on the editorial page, the first editorial is Strange Turn. So, this is regarding Supreme Court's attempt at mediation in the Ayodhya dispute case. So, this is incongruous with earlier standings of the Supreme Court. So, this front page news is discussed in this editorial too here. And this is Road Through Rome. So, this is regarding Italy's proposed endorsement of BRI, that is Belt and Road Initiative of China. So, this highlights the dilemma within the European Union. The lead article, A Peace Movement is Needed. So, this is regarding India and Pakistan. So, it says that India and Pakistan must reimagine the border as a fold of peace instead of a threshold of hostilities. So, war will not bring in a solution. And this is a case for a first front. So, a third or federal front will not be able to confront the challenge of the Hindu right, which challenge the Hindu right poses to India's secular polity. So, this article discusses how a third front will not succeed. So, what is it putting forth is that there should be a first front which should be strengthened. Then on Saturdays on op-ed page, we have a ground zero coverage. So, today the coverage is regarding Bandipur forest fire. So, it says when Bandipur burned, it was prominently covered in news for quite few days. So, it erupted in Bandipur Tiger Reserve a month ago and devastated hundreds of acres of pristine forests. So, this is a report on the mammoth effort that went on into containing the fire. So, this also highlights the need to upgrade firefighting capabilities. So, this is the Bandipur Tiger Reserve in Karnataka. It also further affected the adjoining Mudumalai Tiger Reserve in Tamil Nadu too. We had discussed all this in news. Then on international page, there is no important news. On business page, you have slip and slide. So, this is regarding the dip in a fall in equity funds flows in the country. So, dip in the equity fund flows continues. So, investor sentiments are low. So, that is discussed here. And below here, you have a coverage on the viewpoints of former chairman of Prime Minister's Economic Advisory Council, C. Rangarajan. So, he says that there is a need for constitutional amendment on GST revenue sharing. So, claims that state sovereignty is lost is untrue, he says. And council should, GST council as such includes foreign finance ministers of the states too. So, this is there. Then on the last page, you have this news. NASA captures first air-to-air images of supersonic shockwaves. So, scientists say the pictures will give a boost to research in the aviation sector too. So, these unprecedented photos, never before captured photos of interaction of shockwaves from two supersonic aircrafts. So, this is part of NASA research into developing planes that can fly faster than sound without thunderous sonic booms. So, when aircrafts cross the threshold of around 1,225 km/h at sea level, it produces waves from the pressure it puts on the air around it. So, this merger actually such results into ear-splitting sound. So, there have been maneuvers by NASA's pilots, the Armstrong Flight Research Center pilots in California, and you can see two supersonic jets flew just 30 feet apart below one another, and advanced high-speed cameras captured these images. So, research has been undertaken so that flights can fly at a faster speed without the ear-splitting sound, without these sonic booms. So, this is the research being undertaken. You can see sonic booms can be a major nuisance, capable of not just startling people on the ground but also causing damage. Like they can shatter windows, and this can lead to strong restrictions on supersonic flights over land in jurisdictions like US, etc. So these are the important headlines for today. For a PDF on current affairs coverage, you can go to our website asha.com and download the PDF copy, which will be uploaded there today. So that is it. Thank you.